Thank you very much. Hello and welcome everyone to our conversation about where technology is taking English language learning today. As you've just heard, I'm Lenise Butler from Mexico. I'll have the pleasure of moderating our panel today. With us, we have Isabela Villas-Boas. As you've just been told, she is currently the corporate academic manager at Casa Thomas Jefferson in Brasilia. Sorry, she was formerly where she worked for 30 years and currently a managing partner at Troika. We also have with us Henry Rue, who works as CEO of Victoria's English, and from the UK, Glyn Hughes. Thank you all for being here. We're going to talk today about how technology can provide us with tools for positive change and even for the reimagining of language education. We would like to be thinking about where we are today, where we want to get, what we need to do to get to where we want to be. And we'd love to hear your perspectives as we go. So please don't hesitate to share your thoughts in the chat and any questions that you might have in the Q&A. We'll be coming back to those near the end of the session, so you'll have a chance to participate as well. So why don't we just get started? And we can do so. I'd like to start perhaps with Isabela and Henry, if you can give us your thoughts around what are the positive changes that we should be reaching towards with our use of technology in ELT?
Okay, thank you for having me in this exciting session. I'm looking here at the chat and seeing that there are people from all around the world, lots of people from South America, just like myself, but people from all around the world. So welcome, it's a great pleasure to be here talking to you. Well, in terms of the positive change that I've seen, I've been involved with technology and language teaching for over 20 years, you know, started very early with a very, you know, modest solutions. And we've seen a lot of positive change in these past 20 years. Definitely the capacity to personalize the experience has been one of the greatest positive changes, because now, you know, the adaptability is more advanced than it used to be. The capacity to gauge, you know, the experiences you provide to the learners based on their performance. So this has been a very positive change. I would also like to highlight the use of artificial intelligence for immediate feedback on students' performance, not just, you know, multiple choice answers, automatic corrections, but more, Cambridge has a wonderful system, app for correcting writing that everybody has been praising a lot, and students use it a lot, teachers use it a lot. So this use of technology, you know, to give students immediate feedback is wonderful. I don't think it replaces the teacher. It just saves the teacher's time on first drafts, you know, and helps the teacher focus more on critical thinking, creativity, things that the technology cannot do for them. The greater accessibility, right? The programs have become lighter and more user-friendly, and available in all kinds of devices. So this greater accessibility is wonderful. I just have one concern. I know we're talking about positive change, but from my perspective here in Brazil, a developing country, is that all of this is very positive, but it also helps widen the gap between the haves and the have-nots.
So on my side in France, we've seen a lot of positives on technology, and obviously COVID has thrown us into distance teaching, and we can now serve people all over the country and outside the country in ways that was actually not possible just 3 years ago. So that's, even though, you know, distance teaching might not be perfect, it's made things a lot more practical and a lot more accessible for a lot of people. We've seen technology improve, and for instance, in our network, our special way of teaching is flipped classrooms, and obviously you now have very good online courses that we can give students, and so teachers can focus on the helping, coaching students, helping them actually speak, and that's a wonderful development that was not possible 20 years ago with the technologies you had then. So that's extremely positive. I'd also say technology is getting a bit more friendly, user-friendly, more interesting, more lively. We have wonderful results with the teens taking an online series and doing really interesting things with them. So that's really interesting, because that's technology that was not intended for language teaching, and it could be subverted to getting very, very good results in language teaching. So yeah, lots of positive developments.
Wonderful. So you've both talked a little bit about some of what you've seen and are experiencing today in teaching, and a couple of drawbacks too, Isabella, which there were some comments in the chat saying definitely there's pros and cons to everything, right? But beyond that, what would be your vision of language teaching with technology? Where is it that you think we are heading? What is your vision around teaching with technology?
Would you like to go first now, Henry?
Okay, I will. Well, I think the vision of where tech firms would like to take us is they would like to basically capture as much of the teaching market as they can, for obvious financial reasons. And since fielding teachers or fielding really interactive group sessions is really complex, and technology is not very good at the speaking part of language acquisition, they've obviously, at least so far, been trying to push the market towards more passive and, I'd say, quote-unquote, uninteresting pedagogical approaches to language acquisition, because there's better mastery there and there's better business for them. So if I look at a horror scenario within 10 years' time, in the language schools will just not exist anymore. And the kids will be at home, and the kids or the teens or the adults, and they'll be just playing around on all sorts of fascinating things on their smartphone on their own, and that would be a disaster. Because the speaking component would be missing, and because it'd also be missing the active input from a teacher or from a pedagogue or somebody that can actually help them become a better learner. So that's a negative vision of what it might become. What I would like it to become is something that really integrates current organizations. Like in France, we have, I don't know, maybe 100,000 English teachers and the school system. And these people are totally outside technology. I mean, they don't even have access to the most basic technologies right now. And technological firms are not really thinking of these people. So I think the way to go would be to integrate technology with organizational skills, so that it can become a lot more practical for those people that need it most, and large organizations that would have use for it.
Thank you, Henry. That's very interesting. A bit of a different perspective, I think, that we don't often think about, but the idea of using technology for access is really important. Isabella, did you want to add a bit about your vision of where you'd like to see technology contributing to language learning?
Right. I totally agree with Henry. I think we need the big corporations to think about, accessibility and the provision of technology to the wider population, to public school systems, because what Henry described about France is definitely the same scenario in Brazil. So that's something that concerns me a bit, that we might be, as I said, widening the gap, right? I mean, it's not technology's fault, but we should be doing something to make sure everybody has this this advantage in their learning experience. I recently did a research with public school teachers who were taking an online program developed specifically for Brazilian teachers, on their perspectives on the program and what they would like to see in digital learning of English specifically, okay? Because the level of English in for public school teachers in Brazil isn't as high as we would like it to be. So there's been a lot of investment. So what this research showed me is that, first of all, we need to have solutions that are both web-based and mobile-friendly, because there are different preferences for that. Maybe perhaps some kinds of activities that are mobile friendly that can be done on the go, on the train, in the car, commuting, etc., but others that you need a computer in front of you to think and to move things around, etc., or to write, to produce something. Micro learning is definitely an important issue, you know, dividing the chunks into smaller parts with a beginning, middle, and end, because people have, you know, less time each day. So if they know that they will spend only 10 minutes or 15 minutes and they will start and finish an activity, so dividing the experience into micro learning moments. They also love to get feedback on performance. They love the even, you know, being able to record themselves and then listen, you know, against a model. It doesn't even need artificial intelligence. They love this feature. They really love the idea. They really ask for interaction. So cheaper programs are usually self-paced, do not have an interaction component. So some sort of other possibility of having them interact among themselves, not necessarily with the tutor, with people who are connected at the same time. So that's something that was brought up. Interaction, some sort of gamification to keep them going. So, you know, badges, some sort of rewards, but not on a, you know, a behavioristic level, but encouragement, right? And definitely what I feel, at least about my culture here and people's behavior with learning, is that technology, I mean, the online programs, digital learning, online English programs have to find a way to also develop non-cognitive skills for students to be successful, because they lack the self-management skills. So they do not keep up with the studies. They don't know how to organize their time. So if this were part of the online solution, you know, so the whole experience, if this also helped, I've had experience with flipped learning with all kinds of students, teenagers, adults, teachers. It doesn't work here because they don't do what they have to do to be prepared for the class. So you come to the face-to-face class or the synchronous class planning to do one thing, and what you do is what you have to go over what students should have done at home, and they just don't do it. So this is something that we haven't been able to solve with all the technology.
So thank you. So there's been a lot of chat happening and amongst the participants in the group, some agreeing, some drawing parallels from what the two of you have shared. Some saying, expanding a bit on the idea about how technology can make our lives easier, but brings in some of the negative as well. And one person even says makes our brains a bit lazier, where others are saying technology definitely helps us to share our common and different experiences. Glyn, I don't want you to think that we're ignoring you. We're certainly not. And I think that you are the person to start the next question. I think we'd love to hear your perspective about what does great digital learning actually look like today? And where is it that we want to get to?
Thank you, Lenise, and thank you for asking me to join you all today. Hi to everyone around the world. I've got the chat up here. It's great to see so many people and so many great comments. Really interesting to listen to Isabella and Henry. It's an interesting question about digital learning, and the great digital learning is great learning and great digital content sits alongside other great teaching and learning experiences. And I think it works best when it supplements and facilitates and doesn't seek to replace. And that's what we see. I mean, even as I'm sure, you know, Henry and Isabella will know, especially with Henry and the flipped classroom model, even before the pandemic, the way technology was used to facilitate communication and collaboration and all of these things, was great. So and that works brilliantly. And then Isabella talked about write and improve. It's another example. You can't learn to write using write and improve, but it does a job. It helps teachers to focus on other areas, but it also encourages drafting skills in learners and encourages attention to detail and editing. But there's lots of things it doesn't do. So I would say, and this is the challenge that we're facing in a way, it's remembering that great digital, it's not the course, it's not the thing, you know, with Henry's somewhat dystopian vision of the teachers being replaced and everybody, you know, scrolling through things on their phones. what we want to do is, I think our vision of the future is using those that technology in a way that frees teachers to do the other work. You know, ultimately, learning happens through communication and through educators and through students working together. So that's my view, I guess, where the best digital learning is and where we want to go.
Isabela Henry, did you want to add anything to that? There was a comment in the chat, sorry, before you speak, that just said that especially for English as an additional language learners, transcription can really be a bonus. There's other comments in the chat about how technology is important and helps us do things quicker and easier, but it's important we know how to use the technology correctly. Just to add to what Glyn was saying. Go ahead, Isabela.
Right. I totally agree with Glyn that technology, you know, good online teaching is good teaching. Whatever is good and effective in the traditional face-to-face environment has to be effective in online teaching as well. So all these features, interaction, meaningfulness, personalization, variety of practice, feedback, this is everything we've always done in the classroom and we want to reproduce in online learning. I just think we need to perhaps understand that with technology, we can operate on a different paradigm. So for example, when we talk about watching videos, listening, the receptive skills, definitely, you know, we need to stop thinking that everybody has to be doing the same thing at the same time. I mean, we don't need to play recordings anymore for all the classroom to listen to. And I see people replicating this in their online teaching, and this is not necessary. People have their own audios. They can listen to it as many times as they want at their own pace. So this is absolutely redundant, you know, to keep doing things the way we have been doing things. So I think we also need to move forward with strategies to really personalize and adapt to students' needs. So I see Henry, the future of the teacher, as a curator of content, you know, for the students based on their interests, their level of performance, etc., with the help of technology, and the provider of high order thinking feedback that the technology, at least right now, is not able to provide. Maybe it will in the future, I don't know. Well, if students are able in the future to become independent learners and use technology to learn independently, it means we've done a good job with the social emotional skills, right? So I'm not really sure this is so bad, but there will still be teachers, but we will have a different role. You know, we will help develop this technology, develop this content, curate this content. I don't know if I'm being, you know, maybe too, you know, Black Mirror-ish.
I think that's an excellent point, Isabella. And if I might, Henry, before you give your response, I think it would be good to remind people that you are CEO of an organization that specializes in flipped learning, flipped classroom learning technology. So we'd love to hear your perspective on this as well.
Just an echo on what Isabella just said. I mean, when the pandemic struck and we had to suddenly, you know, bring a lot of classrooms online, we very quickly noticed that really what worked in a physical classroom did not work online. Eventually, we had to go through a whole learning curve. We noticed that the way some of it needs a lot of investment. For instance, if you really want to have a great Zoom class, you need the teacher to be in an environment that will cost you about $25,000. Which is how you get the best results. So it's but you need that for the kind of, you know, for the teacher to be able to access non-verbal cues on the student's face. The face has to be big. I mean, this is just a small detail, but all these things have to be taken into account, and you can't just improvise a great Zoom meeting. Now, to respond to another point, yeah, the teacher's role is certainly changing, and maybe what made our flipped classroom successful is when we understood that we needed the teacher to be most of the time in the classroom with the students, learning online and working on the online tools with them. because most of our students, when they walk in, just don't have an idea of how to study properly. So they will, for instance, attempt to do an exercise without understanding the directions at the top of the exercise, and then they get it all wrong, and obviously they're disappointed. So then it's very basic things, but you know, take your time, understand the instructions first. Practice pronunciation when you're reading something on the screen. I mean, all sorts of very basic things. And once you do take this time with the students individually, then they become much better learners.
There's a lot of debate going on in the chat. There are people agreeing and disagreeing. Just to highlight a few of the things that have come up, Alexandra asked, how can we take advantage of technology in the classroom for speaking if students aren't motivated? There are other similar questions in the chat like that. Lots of commentary about how can we get flipped classroom to actually work if it's beyond a small environment of students. How do we motivate students to work online? As we get into that, I'd like, if we could, I'm going to put out the next question. I think you can include your answers to some of these if you would like. But just like with teaching and learning, what does this actually mean for assessment as well? Because I think that goes to, not directly to motivation, but certainly to student production and how we can look at how well the students are producing with the technology and the approach that we're using in the classroom. So what does it mean for assessment? What does it look like, good digital assessment today? And where is it we want to get to?
Would you like me to take that first?
Yes, sorry, Glyn, perhaps you'd like to start with this one.
Okay, no, that's fine. It's a really interesting one, and as part of that, I'll come back to some of the things that Isabella in particular was talking about, personalization and adaptivity, because that links to assessment as well, because what we need is to measure learners' progress and to understand where they are in order to personalize and adapt. Of course, in many classrooms, there's a challenge there because classes are often working to a common goal. So when you personalize according to ability, how do you make sure that you don't actually make things harder for teachers by having to juggle, you know, 15 different groups of two or three learners rather than one group of 30, and curating individual content sounds great, but we need to make it straightforward for people. So how do you keep that sense of class together and that sense of community within a class where people are off doing their own little personalized and adaptive learning things? And then I guess coming more directly onto the assessment thing, it's really important, but it's really hard because, of course, assessment is how we measure progress. It's how we help to inform people of where they are and what they need to do next. It's how we can help people to prioritize their learning. But assessment is also an accountability mechanism. It's also a way that we tell people whether they've passed or failed. It's a way that the way that school directors can talk about their school or talk to their teachers about what's happening. So we're sort of evangelists for assessment because we can say it's great, you can get all this information about your learners, if we can start investing in ways to give it to you and start we can make it easier for you to see where your learners are, what you need to do next. But we need to do it really carefully, and we need to do it collaborating with schools and with teachers, because otherwise we're in that black mirror world of hyper accountability, where learners are gaming the system and teachers are worried that someone's looking over their shoulder all the time. We need to make sure there's space for people to learn and make mistakes, and because that's all part of the learning process. This without feeling like everything you do is going to be part of your record. So it's really important to find that balance. We don't have the answers, but I think the way we plan to do it is bit by bit and working with teachers and learners and seeing what works. And we won't always get it right, but we'll keep learning.
I'd like to ask Henry and Isabel also to participate with this question about what great digital assessment looks like. And as They do. For those of you who are participating, especially there's a lot of debate going on in the chat, we'd love to hear from you. If you can write from your perspective and your experience, what does great digital teaching and learning look like for you? And what does great digital assessment look like for you? So if you want to start writing in the chat, we'll be monitoring as we go. But Henry, Isabella, if either of you would like to participate with any or expand on any of these ideas.
Do you mind if I start, Isabella? I'd be very old school on this. I think a great digital teaching has got the same characteristics as a great classroom teaching. You have motivated students, people that are keen and eager to attend whatever's going to happen. I would like it to last a little longer if at all possible. I develop great relationships with their peers and their teachers, and are happy to have learned a lot of stuff at the end of the class. So I don't think the goalposts actually change very much because it's online. As for assessment, we are probably the leaders in France for distance supervised assessment, like the Linguistical Anywhere and the TOEIC. And there's huge demand. We're absolutely, we find it's incredible. There is really a big need. People find that doing exams from their home or from the living room or whatever is very practical, doing them on the weekends, doing them whenever they would want to. But they have a lot of issues with technology. So exams, current ways of supervising exams are obviously not as user-friendly as they should be. A lot of youngsters, and this is not mostly not old people, have issues with their computers, with setting up programs, with everything. ETS Global cancels about 15% of the exams they do, but they're not 15% of people, of youngsters trying to cheat, but 15% do something wrong somewhere down the line. So obviously there's a lot of disappointment, but this is obviously a way to go, and I do hope technology will improve over the years.
I think there we won't be able to avoid online assessment for very long. I know that it brings other issues, and it may even be more costly. I'm not sure, but what I'd really like to see is a change in the paradigm, because if we are able to use technology for assessment, we need to change the paradigm of the one day, one specific time to gauge student performance. I think we need to find ways to gauge their performances in different instances on different days, so that we can eliminate, the intervening factors that being tested have on students' production. So I would like to see, because when we think of online assessment, we're transporting to the online environment the same conditions of the paper-based assessment, a set time with all the security, you have to be on this day, this time, etc. So how can we maintain the reliability, but get different instances of student productions at different moments of time? I'm just, it's very easy for me because I'm not involved in producing the test, right, Glyn, the assessment. So I'm just throwing it to you so you can think about it. But we really need to think about a new paradigm for assessment that is not just transferring.
To come in there, I agree. As an assessment organization, our biggest constraint has always been how much information can we get out of people in sort of 2 to 3 hours in order to give them their grade. And we work really hard to make sure that we can draw as many inferences as possible. With changes in technology, it gives us opportunities as well to give better information based on information over a period of time. There are, however, huge, as I said before, lots of cultural associations. The one-off language test in a secure environment will always, for a long time, I think, be really important because of everything that comes with that and the ability to use it in certain ways. However, I think we can be more nuanced in the future about different types of assessment for different reasons and for different to different ends. So not always not wanting to use that one-off assessment event to do everything, but understanding that there are different ways to measure performance that give you different outcomes. And that's what we mean by formative. That's when we talk about formative assessment. It's like, well, we can do it over a period of time. It reduces the burden on that one event, but it also means we can give you different types of information and more granular information, more helpful information. And that's, I think, where we see the future. It's just a question of how we get there in stages.
Thank you for that. I think we need 3 hours for this topic, but I think that we have just time for one more question. And if you could keep your question, your responses brief, so then we can move into some of the questions and concerns from the audience. But if each of you could speak perhaps briefly just to what you see as the current trends in the use of technology in ELT and how that compares with the best use of technology. It's a big question, but if you could just share a couple of your thoughts. Perhaps we could start with Henry and then move to Isabella, and we'll leave Glyn for the end since you just answered last year.
Okay, so I'd say the current trend since COVID has been, organizing things online and getting proficient with all sorts of different formats for distance teaching, distance assessment, and all the rest. And that's not yet integrated. There are lots, vast populations of, teachers, learners. This is a trend that can still go on, I think, for the decade or something of the kind. Now, some of the most exciting things that are happening are in quite different sectors, like, for instance, virtual reality and augmented reality. There are starting to be some interesting applications. Now, they cost a lot of money to produce, and so the duration of the courses tends to be very short, and the scope of what it's focused on is not always very important. But, I mean, some of the things that have been developed are really highly interesting, and they provide an immersive environment for learners. They provide good opportunities for teachers and learners to interact, and I would certainly like to encourage those ventures.
Thank you, Henry. Isabella?
I would like to go back to what I think, I'm sorry, I forget who mentioned this, somebody said that, I'm sorry, I'm trying to keep up here, but okay, I'm sorry, it's too many people, but a participant talked about the fact that not all students have access to all of this technology. So who are we talking about? What is our role as teachers, as educators, as institutions in helping provide this access to everyone? How can we contribute to enhancing the learning experience of students that are not part of these programs that we are involved with, right? Because from what I understand, all of us are involved with kind of elite programs for teaching English, if I'm not mistaken, right? And so we are able to provide the best solutions, cutting edge technology, cutting edge methodology, well-prepared teachers, etc. But what about the big mass that doesn't have access to all of this? How can we, I don't know how to answer this question, but we should always keep an eye on this, because if we don't help, the development of the society and learning as a whole, we will still have the same problems, because we will be discussing 20 years from now the same things, but talking about a different population.
I completely agree with that, Isabella, about understanding how, and I think it's come up a few times, the fact that technology is great, but it also has the it can also have the effect of limiting access to the improvements that it provides. So I don't have the answer either, but I know we need to think about making things accessible across multiple channels and things like that, and in different formats for different places, and making sure that we have a good offer for everybody, including print only, if that's what people can access, and that doesn't get left behind. Coming back, I guess, Lenise, to your question, ever since I was a teacher, which feels like a long time ago now, English language teaching has always been super creative, and teachers do lots of creative and different things in their classroom. But what that leads to, in a way, is quite a fractured landscape, where they're using lots of different teaching tools, lots of different digital tools, trying to keep track of lots of different things in different places, trying to keep track of information. And where I think we might be able to make things better in the future, and compared to where you see other industries, I guess, particularly outside education, is bringing this stuff together to have better, for want of a better word, better analytics, and being able to find out what it all means and what to do next. So being a bit less fractured in how we bring all of this stuff together.
Excellent, thank you. So there's been a lot going on in the chat. I know we've been trying to keep an eye on it. There are moderators in the chats as well. And so we have just a couple of minutes. We're right on time, but we have just a couple of minutes to address some of the questions from the chat. There have been some questions about what do we do about students who don't have access to technology, students who are not interested in using technology. There's also questions about cheating and how students can use technology to sort of get around the rules of teaching and learning. And then there's a lot of concern about motivation and how technology can contribute or in fact detract from motivation to learn English. It seems to me that's been an overarching theme, but I wanted to throw these three main ideas out to you as speakers to see if you would like to perhaps contribute your ideas to these questions. Unfortunately, for those of you who are participating, we can't answer all of your questions, but I'd like to invite the panel now to give some ideas about either any of those three main topics.
Well, I'd like to quote a participant who wrote, "Technology paves the way to independent learning." That's what technology should be doing, to pave the way for independent learning. We should be aiming at developing students' social-emotional skills, especially their self-regulation skills. So we will only be successful with these kinds of resources that we're talking about if we work with on developing students' self-regulation skills, because otherwise we will be really, you know, saying, you know, they're not motivated, they're going to cheat. I think, you know, we should be finding ways to help students understand that when they cheat, they are working against themselves, and not trying to find solutions for students who cheat. You know, we spend a lot of time finding solutions for exceptions and not the rule, because I don't think students who cheat are the rule. So we spend a lot of time and energy, you know, trying to control an unwanted behavior rather than working on people's awareness of how this behavior works against this. So it's a whole, it's a package, right? It's a whole different paradigm in education, in my point of view, in education, in assessment, in priority.
Thank you, Isabela Henry.
I'd like to add to another point. Last time I went to Japan, I had this little machine and I spoke French on one side and came out in Japanese on the other. And that obviously took away all motivation I might have had to learn, you know, beyond the five words of polite Japanese. And I think that's a great use of technology. It actually works really well. And that's taking away, it's noticeable in France already, that's taking away the drive of adult learners to improve their English. Because if they reach the age of 40 and the English isn't good, they can just, you know, have one of these apps, and that solves most of the problem for them.
really interesting, Henry. I wonder if you ever got strange looks and if you knew what was coming out of the other end of your phone and whether it was really what you thought it was. I guess coming back to the point, it's about motivation. Completely agree also with Isabella about self-regulated learning, and a lot of that still becomes, I think it was Henry that said, the teacher being there and talking learners through what it can and what it can't do. And then I guess where it can help with motivation is where it can personalize and be adaptive. So we're giving learners something that's the right level of challenge for them, rather than something that's too easy or too hard. And where learners can get instant feedback. So you don't need to wait for the teacher to mark it and you find out a week later when you've forgotten what you've done. So you immediately, even, you know, there's write and improve, but even with a multiple choice question, you can immediately see, oh, I got it wrong. Now I remember what I did and I can go and look where I got it wrong. So I think that sort of instant feedback can be quite a powerful motivator. But technology, it is impersonal, it is just the phone in front of you. There is a temptation, particularly if English is one of your many subjects in school, to find the way to get to complete it as quickly as possible. And that's where that self-regulation and the role of the teacher comes in. And at the end of the day, learners taking responsibility for their learning, which, you know, technology is never going to remove that need.
Thank you. So we have just maybe 1 minute each, if you'd like to each give some closing thoughts. I think that you've brought in some amazing and informed perspectives on around all of these questions. There's so many left out there that we weren't able to attack today, but there's been great information going on in the chat and from our speakers. So I'd like to invite each of you, if you could just give your closing thoughts, perhaps about 1 minute, and that will bring us right up to time. Isabella, could you start and then move to Henry and finally Glyn?
Sure. I guess there's an aspect here that everybody in the chat agrees with, is that technology is very useful. It's here to stay and we should take the best advantage of it, but it's a tool and it doesn't replace everything, right? But again, we should be worried as teachers in doing what technology cannot do. So again, emphasizing the soft skills and the non-cognitive skills that are so important in today's world, in today's job market, and that we are So we have a very important role there. I would say also, you know, from my experience teaching online and doing flipped learning, etc., I really agree with Henry. Sometimes all students need is for you to sit there with them in front of the screen and help them out, do an exercise, more moments of silence, more a little time for independent thinking. You know, maybe we're trying to fill them up with too many Kahoots and Jamboards and too many activities that do not really, as Glyn said, fractured landscape, right? Fractured activities that don't really have a link to each other. So maybe we should relax a little more too, you know, and take advantage of our role, even if we are conducting this online with students.
Thank you, Isabella. Henry?
Well, I would like to conclude with a little pitch for YouTube and other similar platforms, because my experience of talking to our students is a lot of them are really curious about how the rest of the world lives their lives and what people in other countries think and do and eat and how they walk their dogs and cats, you know, and all the rest. And there's technology has been, these are not technologies that were intended for that purpose, but they're absolutely wonderful at bringing foreign countries and foreign cultures to our doorstep. And this is something that is not yet widely used in the classroom or elsewhere, but that has really fantastic teaching potential.
Thank you, Henry. Glyn, your final thought?
Yeah, I lost to cover. I think the accessibility, the access to technology thread has been really interesting, and that's something we're definitely going to take away from this. And I think it's something that we need to bear in mind. It's interesting listening to the YouTube thing. Part of what we learn with technology is that it's really helped lots of super motivated learners learn English. So people that play, multiplayer online games learn and so often we think, well, why can't we replicate this? How do we replicate that? part of our job, I think, as people involved in English language education, is to help the people that don't find those areas of motivation, to help the people that don't have that magic key to it. And I think that's where all of the tools that we have come in, and it's incremental, and we keep trying things, and some things will work better than others, but let's keep learning as we go along.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you to Glyn, to Isabella, to Henry for your time today, and for all of you who have participated in the session. I'm afraid that's all we have time for, but the conference continues. Enjoy the rest of your sessions. Thank you for your participation, and we look forward to seeing you all very soon in your next session. Thank you very much.